the day before we have our dialogue, is Sinead McLaughlin, who is the City Council. She's the Environmental Awareness Officer. And she will be here today to tell us a bit about biodiversity on the Shannon and the City Council involvement with the Shannon and water in general. Welcome to Sinead.
And folks, how are you doing? I suppose the first thing to say is I am not an expert in Shannon. Please don't think that I am. But I did put together this presentation from Mary 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 Kelly asked me to be part of this project. So I suppose the first thing to say about the Shannon is we have to get water from the water. And the Derwent Water Treatment Facility is a state-of-the-art facility. It's reopened relatively recently. It supplies drinking water for up to 90,000 people in that region, and all of them are city, parts of the county, and parts of Clare, and that's the drinking water supply. So just keep that in mind as well. I realise that this is more artistic than that, maybe, but I think it's important for me today. And the other thing, just from the City Council point of view, water safety, there's a water safety officer in the department, in the City Council. They're based up at the fire station. That's the Water Safety Development Officer. They work with the Irish Water Safety Council, there's a Civil Safety Committee, and then there's a the Limerick City Fire and Rescue, and then also the Limerick Green Search and Rescue Team. So they would work together on water safety there. But if you see a live fire or something like that needs to be replaced or whatever, it's actually the Water Safety Development Officer. There's also a Shannon Estuary anti-pollution team. I don't know whether to come back from time to time or help out, or maybe call in as somebody who's very frequently on the river. It's fair to say that oil spills are relatively infrequent on the river. But there is this team. Limerick City Council, with five other local authorities, with the Shannon Point Company, and they would work together. They would do regular exercises. They work with people like Birdwatch Ireland. They would be trained up on how to de-oil birds, all of the bush birds out from oil spill, all of that sort of thing. And sorry, no, it's the policy in Limerick City Council to respond to all reports of pollution in the river, and that's pretty much what happens. I put in this because Limerick is making great strides in climate counts, as in numbers of applications in the city. Okay, and you can see that on their Facebook page. This is the business city centre area is actually entering climate counts this year, and you can see that's one of the areas that Patrick just talked about in the video there. They're just trying to raise the profile of Limerick in a very, very positive way. They're trying to change the image by putting their best foot forward and getting volunteers on board, and they're meeting every Wednesday evenings and Sundays now, and they're actually doing cleanups in the city centre. And I know Miriam, you were on the first one, weren't you, with Miriam still there, and as you reported the San Martins, wasn't it, on their Facebook page? Yeah. So if you're on Facebook, please like this page. They need all the support they can get. This is one of the pictures that featured in the Love Limerick Don't Litter calendar 2011. So found out the feature in the month of August, the picture itself was probably taken around October, because that was when we ran the competition for entries. But it's a beautiful picture of the Shannon, I think, and the lovely board that's in there. And I suppose it is fair to say that there is more emphasis on turning the current towards the Shannon. And we will see next year the far side of the river, Harley's Key and Harley's Key, Fisher's Key, that side. There is going to be development along that side as well. Positive development like this in terms of water. Another Facebook page for you to like. I spent nearly 40 minutes on the radio recently to do a dog dirt on this thing. If you walk a dog, please bring it back with you. Please clean up after your dog. That's what's very badly. We're asking visitors. We want to clean for our own citizens, but we're asking visitors to go over these walkways. It's your responsibility. Don't care whether there's been nearby or not, to be honest, and I know that's the wrong thing for somebody from the council to say, but it is your responsibility to clean up after your dog if you have. Okay, so just facts about the Shannon. It's 240 metres long, so it's Ireland's longest river. It rises in an area called the Shannon Pot in the mountains of Cavan. It has a 17-mile estuary just outside of the river. Okay, the river is shallow, and actually calculating this as well, not rising more than 250 feet above sea level at its highest point. And actually that makes it, it's not very navigable the whole way up for large industrial vessels. So that has probably protected it somewhat as well, if you like. I know there's place for development a lot of that in industry, but it's probably protected it to some degree as well. And it gets its river from the Celtic cross, the goddess Lunas, Shire. In the city itself, now that's within the current Lunar city boundary, if you like, which is quite small. And obviously that's going to change when the two councils merge. Okay, there's only about 16 kilometres of waterway within the current Lunar city boundary. With the exception of the Grand Canal segment between the Lochiel and Ray Road, which is about 1.5 kilometres, all of the waterways are tidal. Now, the Park Canal is the park, and I put the Park Canal brackets, that's what we would want as the Park Canal, and that's where the areas that the Limerick Biodiversity Network, the Mirren Company, spoke about this morning, the planting seeds that they've undertaken there, all done by volunteers, by the way, which is fantastic. And council are very happy to support initiatives like that. Oh, Guinness is the Guinness Canal. And there was a Guinness depot there once when there was a lot of traffic on the canal, and that's where Guinness was coming in. It was a sort of warehouse, wasn't it, really? And part of the river down the downstream is classed and marked as a green. So it's predominantly fresh water. It has some saline incursions in the city area. It's the main natural habitat in Limerick City. And actually, I think I actually forgot to list it in the thing. It's a special area of conservation. Okay, parts that are actually not within the city. Parts that are SPAs as well, which is a special protected area. And that's a kind of a bird's designation, if you like. It's home to many of our aquatic plants and animals, and obviously it's a cultural community, as was mentioned earlier, fishing, rowing, and all of those things. I don't know, that's probably not so easy to read. This is one of the maps that's going to be in our biodiversity plan, which is in draft form at the moment. Okay, and we hope that that will be looking at sometime in the year, but give a definite date, because I'm afraid of that. But obviously, one of the key focuses is actually around the channel, and then all of the wetland areas associated with the channel, and then all of the dark green spaces are just kind of open spaces that are well known to biodiversity as well. And they could be, some of them might be city council open places like the public square or Clare Street, some of them might be actually the grounds of a secondary school or a third level college or whatever it might be. Okay. The wetlands that are into the channel that kind of we would be most familiar with in, I suppose, from the council's perspective, would be the Park Canal. Healy's Field is just off the Park Canal, if you like, near the Wood Island Shopping Centre, if you know that area. King's Island, St. Mary's Park, Long Pavement, the Moiross area, okay? Long Pavement was the site of the old city, and I will call it a dump at the time, okay? And that's not undergone extensive renovation, okay? Which is just about complete at this stage. Okay, and that's all about environmental, protecting the environment. That was done under an EPA license. Okay. Lewistock, Shannon Fields, Corbley, Westfields Wetland, I'll mention that again. The Kuna Settlement Ponds. Now, the Kuna area, it's all tied up in the big new road development, the tunnel, all of that. And also, that area would have been outside our functional area until the cut was 2006, 2007, Carradine, that greater area came into the council's functional area, if you like. The Shannon type of that's Ballinacourt Creek, Racecourse Lands, Ballinacourt Creek, Baggett Estate. Now, the Baggett Estate has actually been split in two, if you like, by the new road. Okay, so we have a Ballinacourt kind of more wetland area, and then what is more like a forested area, I suppose. Okay. And then the Long Pavement, there's constructed wetland on Long Pavement, as well as obviously the wetland areas on Long Pavement area. And just in terms of ecosystems, an essential element of biodiversity, when we look at, I'm not a great person to be able to identify individual species, but I always recognise the connection that if one species is there, it depends on another, which depends on another, which depends on another. Okay, and that's actually, you can protect like, I don't know, parent development without looking after the rest of the food chain at all. And that's true of every species. Well, if you can kind of, when I say a general way, don't take it the wrong way, if you can overall mind your habitats, the rest should, in theory, look after itself, okay? In theory. And when I say mind your habitats, I'm not necessarily talking about going in there and actively managing them like crazy. Sometimes the management might be monitor, see what it does, do you know? Sometimes there will be changes, and there is always changes in nature. There's always changes in nature. Okay, and you know, sometimes some of the changes could be well without of our outside our control, you know, as just your average interested person, or possibly sometimes beyond control of council and other groups that may look like they have more control than they do. So basically, ecosystems are independent, functioning systems of plants, animals, microorganisms. They can be as large as the River Shannon or as small as what's going on in the tropics. Without the support of other organisms within an ecosystem, life forms wouldn't survive. And basically, things like predator prey, food, shelter, all of that sort of stuff that's required basically to keep animals and insects, all of those things around. And I don't think, like most of us in the summer, we go out and we go on the midges and we go back in again. But the midges, like some of that species, we eat up to 3,000 of them in the evening. Same thing of our swallows. Do you know what I mean? So, we don't like them, they have their place, you know. I'm going to mention about the state wetland. It is basically off the Ballinaclough River, if you like, but the Ballinaclough is a tributary into the Shannon, okay? And this wetland area, this was actually a constructed wetland, just off the main overdubbing drain that prevents flooding, okay, off that river. And it's a lovely, lovely area. And if any of you would like to go walk there at some stage, now I haven't been up recently, this is when it was in its construction phase. If you see this little channel here, that was basically how narrow the whole channel was. Okay? It was even more narrow than that. So that they opened it right up, they kind of developed islands within it. And it's not looking to make this, see the area that's underwater there and in behind over there. It's not looking to make that underwater all the time. It's actually that it will flood at least once or twice a year. Okay? So it is still technically a wetland. But so you're kind of moving from, you have open water, you have your grassy bank on the embankment of the OPW embankment, flood protection, I suppose. Then you have the Ballinaclough River moving outside this area, okay? And then you have the trees in the background. Now, a lot of them are conifer trees. We did talk about taking them out. Some of them did come out for this construction. But we've also planted 200 deciduous trees, things like crab apple, hazel, willow, all sort of indigenous species, all of the wildlife, just moving to the right of that, if you like, and coming back. And that's all happened in the last 2 years. That project was completed in, I don't say last November, maybe. Okay? And it's lovely. And actually, again, I'm not a person who knows a lot about individual species, but there's a little egret regularly seen there. And although little egrets aren't indigenous to Ireland, they're beginning to naturalize, and they certainly nested down in Cork and maybe other places, I'm not sure. Okay, so it is possible that eventually we might see something like that nest there. And the egrets are very like herons, except smaller, but they're that kind of shape and they're so white and handsome. This is Westfields Wetlands, and I put in Westfields Wetland Committee. I don't know if there's anybody from Westfields Wetland Committee here today. Westfields Wetland Committee has been very active in this area, which is great. And again, it's about volunteer support and people taking pride in the area, and you know, you couldn't, in some ways, you couldn't have a nicer thing on your doorstep than Westfield. Because if you look at the surrounding, the houses there, they just all open up. You come out your front door, and you're in Westfield, and you have this beautiful open water area. And on this side, where all the photographs of individual animals and species are, you just have sedge, high sedge, and willow, and that sort of thing. And it's absolutely beautiful. And if you go the whole way down to at Ted Russell Park. You come, if you like, if you walk up that stretch, you're actually coming from a very managed grassland, if you like, and then it grades nicely into something that gets wilder and wilder. And then, okay, this area around Westfields is, it's a low maintenance management, if you like. I wouldn't say it's quite, it's not a formal park, but, you know, you have a nice walkway around it, and then you have this lovely open water area, and certainly there's crew nesting there, there's top to duck there at the moment, there's Butte Swan nesting there at the moment, mallards, there's mallard there, there's always mallard there. There may be one or two other things. And actually, we had a walk last Saturday, and we walked as part of the Tiny Towns initiative, because biodiversity is a category in Tiny Towns. And we actually started in the Hunt Museum, the Garland Hunt Museum, where we could look at San Martin's nesting in the wall there of the Data Market, and walked along Harvey's Key, Arthur's Key Park, if you like, right through, down over Shannon Bridge. They went into St. Michael, down near St. Michael's Rowing Club, then out along the Pinjana Road and across to Westfields, and finished in Westfields. And it was a lovely walk. It was led by John Murphy, who is a wildlife photographer as well as other things. Associated with weeds and sedge. John could hear sedge borders there last week. I couldn't particularly. He's able to pick out the sound for us. Grey heron, you would see very regularly at Westfields. Very, very regularly there. But you also have your common garden birds there. You know, your robins, your blackbirds and song thrushes and all of that. And that little bird there is the black cap. And people most regularly see that in their gardens in the winter time. But they are in Ireland throughout the year, but we get an influx in the winter as well. They love that place when they hear the birds of winter abroad every now and then. It's a very nice area now. It's a very nice area to walk. And, Dometon Bat, and this week, actually, I think it's down in Pat's area. We actually led a lovely walk, I think it was a good few years ago now, with Conor Kellerman. And we heard four species on the right. We heard orchids, orchid and scolita, and then went for a walk after that. And people stayed until, I think it was about 2 in the morning, down by the baths and everything. It was lovely. But this is the bath that is most associated with water, the Dometon Bat. And I put a question mark there. When I started being interested in a formal sense of wildlife, I suppose, there were seven species of bat. There's 10 now. So you have to remember that about, we don't necessarily know everything that's out there yet either. We talked about interdependence, etc. We talked about food chains. I don't know why I had to put in an oak tree there, but I did. And I remember beautiful moths. It's a very good moth expert in there called Kevin Hall. And he actually was very helpful to get it up the biodiversity ground, gave me all the species lists and everything. In the biodiversity plan, one of the things we're hoping that the joint cover will have is like the River Shannon, somebody fishing on it, we'll have the salmon, we'll have mayfly larvae, we'll have mayfly, and I'm not 100% sure, that one might be a damsel fly there, if somebody can correct that, more than it is, okay, damsel fly. Again, what we're trying to do from the very beginning of the biodiversity plan is get in the food chains, get in that connections, get into the swifts swimming over the river all through town here. It's fabulous at the moment. Our caterpillars on nasturtiums, ladybirds. Remember, all of these things require things like nettles. They require the things that we're not gardening for necessarily. Take our honeybees, for instance. We have one of my colleagues in Australia, the keeper, and he said his bees would pass out apple blossom for dinner. And yet, how do we do it for dinner? So it's just a little thing to keep in mind. Food chains. Lucky enough, the day I was out in the Baltic States, the kingfisher was flying by. Thrilled to see it. It tends to mean that things are in order if you see something like a kingfisher there. And the same thing with when you see otter. And it's been just November now when my colleague Stranger said, just seen an otter with a treaty stone. Wintering visitors on either side. I should have actually had wader species. Talking about the shadow, but you will see these all around the field bearing, right? I'm going to read out one fun fact, because this, I'm going to have these in the biodiversity plan as well. From the time a dragonfly hatches, it can live anywhere from 6 months to 6 years, but only about 2 months of it is actually a dragonfly. Most of